Alright, in this video I'm going to do one case of how to solve a linear system of differential equations. I'm using the eigenvalue eigenvector method, so the three cases would be: one case is you have complex eigenvalues, another case is where you have two real values, and then another case would be if you had repeated real values. But I'm going to just do the case where you get complex eigenvalues in this example, and also in all my examples, probably the matrix of constant coefficients, which is labeled A here, will be 2 by 2. So the solution is a linear combination of two equations. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. I have the problem written here. So since I already said we're using the eigenvalue and eigenvector method, we're going to first find the eigenvalues. And I already said that in this case, the values will be complex. So let's go ahead and start solving for the two eigenvalues. We have the equation lambda squared minus t lambda plus d equals 0 to solve for what lambda is. In this case, the t is the trace of the matrix A, and d stands for the determinant of the matrix. So the trace is the sum of this diagonal. In this case, it's going to be 0. The determinant is the multiplication of this, so that's negative 16 minus the multiplication of the other diagonal, so that's minus negative 32, which gives 16. So the equation is lambda squared minus 0 lambda plus 16 equals to 0. If we solve for lambda, we get negative 0 plus or minus square root of 0 squared minus 4 times 16 all over 2. So that's going to give you 0 plus or minus 4i. So we have solved for the first and the second eigenvalues, which is lambda. Next, we can use another equation to find the eigenvectors. So the equation is the matrix A minus the eigenvalues times the identity times your vectors, so in this case it's going to be v1, v2, equals to 0. So we're going to do the first case, lambda 1, which is 0 plus 4i. I usually just do the first one as a positive, and you don't have to do the second one because the answer will just be the conjugate of the first one you do. So let's go ahead and plug everything in. So we have that A is negative 4 minus 8, 4, 4 minus the identity matrix. If you don't know, that's just ones on the diagonal. So if we have a 2 by 2, it's going to look like that. So if we multiply lambda times the identity, we get, and we're just doing the first lambda, so we get 0 plus 4i, or just 4i, 0, 0, and then 4i times v1, v2. So this is multiplied, or this is in brackets first, and then it's all multiplied by v1, v2, equal to 0. So let's go ahead and subtract across matrices. So we get negative 4 minus 4i. So that's negative 4 minus 0, so negative 4. And then 0 minus, or 0i minus 4i is minus 4i. Negative 8 minus 0 is negative 8. 4 minus 0 is 4. And 4 minus 4i is 4 minus 4i times v1, v2 equal to 0. The next step that you want to do is find the solution to v1 and v2. So when you do matrix multiplication, you can get two equations equal to 0 to solve for v1 or v2. You can just, for these complex cases, most of the times you can just use the first row, right? But for complex cases, if you think it's going to give you weird values that are not simple or whole numbers, for example, then you can look at the second row. For me, it just seems easier because you know you're going to divide by 4 to use the second row instead of the first one. So we'll just ignore the first row and just use the second equation to find v1 and v2. So when you multiply the row and the column, you get 4v1 plus 4 minus 4i v2 equal to 0. And then from here, usually, again, what I do is just plug in 1 for either v1 or v2 and then see what that gives me for the other value. So since this has the complex case and this just has the 4, I'll plug in 1 to v2. So I'm going to say v2 is 1. And when that's 1, we have negative 4 plus 4i equal to 4v1. So I just plugged in 1 and then moved this part to the right-hand side of the equation. Then we're going to solve for v1. So v1 is equal to negative 1 plus I. So when v2 is 1, the second row gives us that v1 will be negative 1 plus I. So now we have the eigenvectors, or the eigenvector, and we have the eigenvalue for the first lambda 1 that we found. And like I said, this means that so we already know the solution because the second case would just be the conjugate. So the second answer is lambda 2 is 0 minus 4i, and the eigenvector for that would be negative 1 minus I 1, because that's just the conjugate of both the vector and the eigenvalue. So if we could stop there at just solving for the imaginary solution, which we can't because the question says solve for real solutions, we would have that y of t is equal to c1 e to the 0 plus 4i negative 1 plus I 1 plus c2 e to the 0 minus 4i negative 1 minus I 1. So we can use this to go one step further and find the real solutions. So what you're going to need to do, well, first of all, you can simplify because e to the 0 is just 1, so you can really just act like that's not there, and you can act like that's not there. Then we're going to use Euler's formula to get rid of the imaginary values. Euler's formula is that e to the it is equal to cosine t plus I sine t. In this case, we have e to the 4i, so t is 4. Oh, sorry, this should be t's. We have the coefficient as 4, so the coefficient goes with the t's. So what I mean by that is e to the 4it is equal to cosine 4t plus I sine 4t. Alright, and then we can plug in where we see e to the 4it, we can plug in this right hand side. So let's go ahead and do that next. We're really not going to worry about the conjugated second part because we're going to basically separate real and imaginary values and use that as the linear combination for the two solutions. So what I mean by that is you don't really have to worry about the second part, and I'll show you why, and it'll all make sense later. So let's go ahead and plug in Euler's formula. So we have C1, and then we're going to plug in here, times cosine 4t plus I sine 4t times negative 1 plus I times 1. And then the second part, don't worry about it. So what we're going to do next is we're going to multiply this part by the vectors. So that would give you C1 times negative cosine 4t. So that's that part, and then you're basically just FOILing, right? So it's plus I cosine 4t minus I sine 4t plus I squared sine 4t. That's the first part. Then you also have to do the second part of the vector. So that would be cosine 4t plus I sine 4t. And then again, you're not worrying about the second part. So next, what we're going to do is we're going to separate here the one where you have, where you had to FOIL, where you were multiplying two binomials. You have to separate the imaginary and the real parts. So I squared, I is the square root of negative 1, obviously, so I squared is negative 1. So this is actually a real value. So we're going to separate it. So really that matrix is negative cosine 4t minus sine 4t plus I cosine 4t minus I sine 4t, and then the bottom is just the same. So our final solution is going to be us separating the real values from the imaginary values, and then you can just get rid of the I. What I mean by that is that the final solution is that y of t is equal to c1, and then e to the 0 was just 1, so it's times the vector. Let's do the real parts first. So the real part here is, let me write this out again, so that's cosine 4t plus I sine 4t. If we're separating just the real parts, we're going to get negative cosine 4t minus sine 4t, and then the real part here is cosine 4t. So that's the first vector, and the second vector will be c2 times the imaginary part, which we're just including the real valued part of the imaginary part, if that makes any sense. So it's going to be cosine 4t minus sine 4t, and the second value is sine 4t, and that's the final solution. So the reason I said you could ignore the conjugate part was because you can actually separate the real and imaginary parts from just the first lambda that you do to get two linearly independent solutions to your system. So that works as a final answer, and hopefully that makes sense. So this is basically the same steps that you would do for the case where you have two real eigenvalues. However, there's just the extra step of after you find the imaginary solution, you apply Euler's formula, and then you just have to simplify and separate the real and imaginary parts.